And
oh my
now
God,
I am.
That was going to be our intro until you fucked up.
That could honestly be the quote for every week. This was supposed to be our intro, but you fucked it up.
Cookie, did you have Neil try your coffee?
I did.
It was pleasant and very suitable on a day like September 3rd. Episode 30 of the Fancy Ramen Podcast. I'm Neil.
I'm Cookie.
I'm
Lizzie. Scott. Oh, sorry. You came in after me, which means...
And I'm Lizzie.
It's not like there's anything I can do to fix that. No.
Oh, God.
Not
at Neil doesn't edit, it? Right?
Now I don't have to edit since we've already acknowledged it.
Sweet.
So... Lizzie, you're on especially for one specific topic that I think everyone here is excited to talk about.
I don't know if excited is the word.
It sounds like you're flabbergasted about how amazing this show is or was or movie.
No.
And actually, I'm going to interrupt for a second. Is that a Final Fight shirt, Cookie?
Street Fighter, man. Yeah.
I don't think it's Street Fighter.
No, yeah, it's a Street Fighter shirt.
But that fight looks like it's from Final Fight.
Oh, no, no. The fight's from the new Street Fighter 8. This is the font they used for like their KOs and things. It's a Street Fighter shirt.
Okay, interesting. Oh, no, now I see the Street Fighter 5. Sorry. All right. Interruptions aside, Cookie has a cool Street Fighter shirt that's pretty badass.
I'm sorry. I can go upstairs and grab the hat, too.
You can. Oh, there's a hat, too?
Yeah, there's a hat.
We'll have to see it later. Yeah, so everyone in this room, with the exception of myself, has seen the new Netflix live-action version of Death Note.
Wait, you didn't watch it?
Fuck no.
He probably read my title for it in the show notes.
It's awful.
I'll say my part in a little bit, but let's talk about white stains. What is the term? Whitewashed, yeah. Whitewashed Death Note.
They explained the whitewashing part okay.
Yeah, actually,
did they?
They have a complete rationale for it.
Yeah, they were like, so we're not in Japan, we're in Chicago. As a matter of fact, he went with...
Seattle.
They're in Seattle, thank you, sorry. Matter of fact, they even went with a... He used the name to kind of draw attention to the fact that he's not in Japan.
Right.
So he kind of, like, said, yeah, okay, this is not happening in Japan.
Ooh. So is his name not Light Yagami?
His name is not Yagami Light.
It's Light Turner.
Yeah.
So my father...
What a great name.
My father, Heavy Turner.
But yeah, so if you guys haven't caught up, we're talking about the Death Note movie, a Netflix original.
So there's obviously going to be spoilers in this conversation.
Sure.
To the movie and potentially the anime.
Yep.
So the beginning had like a lot of very confusing things. So the only, in the anime, the guy, Light, was really, really smart. Well, in this, the only time they were kind of saying he was smart is they had him doing homework for other kids. But he didn't even finish the homework and he gave it to the guy.
And got paid for it.
Yeah, the little video, the parody video or whatever, the editor... I don't even know what to call it, but the reaction video I saw from Cookie shows Light working on algebra.
Right.
Yes. Light's super smart. So he's working on algebra and...
No, I think he's in high school.
Yeah, I think he's high school.
Yeah, in this movie.
Regardless, I was taking calculus in high school.
I know.
And yeah,
I wasn't even like an AP student.
Yeah, algebra is like a middle school thing in the States these days. If you're smart... Like, if you're in an advanced math track, you've probably done algebra before you've even gone to high school.
Right.
Solve
so, Light Turner is the smartest kid in his incredibly dumb high school.
Well, and then the girl character, I guess. She was doing cheerleading thing, and she was, like, smoking a cigarette while practicing, and I was just like, that's the only time in the movie she's smoking a cigarette. It's just like, oh, so just to, like, get off, like, make her seem cool at the beginning, I don't know. It was dumb.
Are you insinuating that maybe blonde gothic Lolita was not going to fly in this version of Death Note?
I guess not. So the chick, in the anime was a blonde gothic Lolita.
Oh, nice.
Lisa. So yeah. She was blonde and she wore like the goth clothes, but it was all frilly and shit. So gothic Lolita. For those who didn't know what gothic Lolita was. My wife looked at us like we were crazy.
No, I know what it is. Okay. One of my friends is Lolita.
Oh, yeah. I guess that makes sense.
Wait, what? One of your friends is Lolita?
Yeah, she dresses Lolita.
Wait, but I think there's a difference between Lolita and gothic Lolita. Lolita.
Yeah, she's just Lolita. Like, really girly girl.
Oh, is that what that is?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, versus gothic Lolita, which is
my perception
black
of Lolita.
Lolita
is changed because of 4chan, so...
Well, no, you're talking about Nabokov's, like, Lolita, right? You know what I'm talking about? The it's an old, like, classic literature book called Lolita by, who knows what his name is. It's Nabokov. I don't know his first name. He's a Russian writer. He wrote it, I don't know, early 20th century, maybe?
Is it about things that are potentially illegal in the countries of our listeners?
Exactly. It's a novel that's basically referenced or used as a reference now to an adult who becomes obsessed with a younger person who would be below any sort of consenting age that he gets involved with later after becoming like her stepfather.
Holy crap.
It's really fucked up, but that's actually where Lolita comes from as far as like a referential term.
Not only do I feel a little dirty from having this conversation, but I just got a picture of her Lolita friend and she looks like a Disney princess basically.
It's like, yeah, she looks like a doll almost.
Yeah. I think that's definitely part of the style is to be very dollish.
Right.
Is she saving herself for her Disney princess? Prince, I mean, fuck. Well, I mean, you know what? It's not my right to say that she's waiting for a prince either, so.
Right. No, I think this is actually her boyfriend.
Yeah, she could be waiting for her dude.
Wow, you know what? Like, no offense to him. He seems like a really chill, cool guy, but I was expecting someone with blonde hair wearing, like, you know, shoulder puffy shirts.
Oh, God.
And with, like, a doublet, at least.
Here's your gothic Lolita.
Oh, I just pulled it
that's
up, too.
That's baby metal that you're showing me. Okay, we have so many fucking visuals here that are not working for the podcast. Death
oh,
Note.
Oh, yeah, true.
Death
oh, yeah.
Note, hot garbage, hot dumpster fire. It's what level of shit are we talking here?
I mean, well, Netflix only allows us to give 2 ratings anymore, which is thumbs up, thumbs down. So I think it pretty much secures its space in the lower 49% as a thumbs down kind of film. Light Turner is a whiny, stupid, lame main character that I can't find myself cheering for or like being interested in succeeding at all, unlike Yagami Light, who... I think part of the excitement in Death Note is even with the introduction of L, you're kind of cheering for both of them to win. Or at least like you don't want to see Light fail necessarily. Like he's the type of anti-hero you can get behind. But this Light Turner, I was just like, I can't wait till he gets busted. He's going to screw up so bad.
Right.
And he did it so fast.
I guess the one character I did like in the movie was L. I thought they did a good portrayal of L.
Angry L, I love it. Like at the end when they kill. Oh, I assume we're letting spoilers.
Oh yeah,
run amok on this. Because really, if anybody's gonna listen to our review and then watch it, they're not really caring what our opinion is at that point. So.
Or they just want to see how horrible it is.
Yeah. I mean, you might as well sit down with a handful of popcorn and enjoy the train wreck that it is.
Yes.
But once Watari gets killed and L is just like, that's fine. I'm just going to shoot Light in the face with a gun. Who cares about the law anymore? I was like, all right, I like this L. I can get behind him. I definitely wanted to cheer for him even harder at that point, which they leave kind of an open-ended ending, don't they? That L finds a page of the Death Note.
Yeah.
He finds a page of the Death Note. Everybody knows that Light is Light.
Kira. Yeah.
Kira, thank you.
And I assume this L, like, unless there's some weird character development that happens that we're unaware of, once this L finds a pen, it's over for Light Turner.
Right.
Which is fine. He can just he's already in the hospital, like on a crash cart or a gurney or whatever. So,
wait, I kind of, I'll be honest, I just kind of dropped out of this conversation for a second.
That's fine. You're not missing anything.
At the end of the movie, Light and L are both alive, correct?
Yes.
Except in a twist of fate, L knows who Light is.
Yep.
And he has a Death Note.
He has a Death Note page.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's just cuts to Farouk laughing over L in the hospital.
Right.
Because he knows L has a page.
Ryuk.
Yeah, Ryuk. Yeah. Sorry, who's Farouk?
Farouk's the genie that is next to Ryuk. L is actually at the very end of the movie, L is in Mia's home and just pulled out a page from the Death Note that was hidden in Mia's calculus book. And Light is on a gurney after sort of faking his own coma/death. And he's telling his dad, who he didn't kill, how he did all of it. So he's confessing to his dad, the police officer. And then the movie just kind of ends, with Willem Dafoe Ryuk, which was great casting. Like, I think Sierra had made a comment that the casting for L and Ryuk was awesome. And
yeah,
it's too bad.
I liked Ryuk, too.
Who plays L?
Some black guy.
Yeah,
I liked that.
That's all we really know. I think the only really identifiable actor is Willem Dafoe.
Because we knew it's Willem Dafoe.
Yeah, there, I mean,
there's
he's got
just
the voice.
An interesting thing to point out. Like, I hate the whitewashing of Hollywood, and I guess I don't know if this is necessarily Hollywood, but by extension. But at the same time, I also find it always very
weird when it's a random black guy.
No, I find it positive when they cast other ethnicities in as characters that are predominant or like were otherwise a different or otherwise Caucasian, like Roland from the Gunslinger or the Dark Tower series is black.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
I thought, like, just to myself that, oh yeah, that's, I think that's good. I think that is good.
Right.
Yeah, and they made explanations for it, too, just by having this be a different narrative than
they made
the
explanations as in, whoa, you're black. Yes, I am black.
Yes. No, I mean, like, with all of their casting decisions, they at least cover it by implying that the thing with Light has already happened, or maybe not has already happened, but they're implying that, you know, that Death Note narrative is different from the one in this live action movie.
Yeah.
Because I guess there can't be two L's, but this L that they made, like, although he has some mannerisms that are similar to L from the anime, he definitely has his own personality type, which actually I think was a strength. Like, it was really cool. There was no reason to have a super intelligent and calculating L when he's going up a, like, super stupid Light anyway. Like,
yeah,
this L is still really smart, but he doesn't need to be super cool and calculating because the Light he's against is a cakewalk.
He doesn't need to be in pajamas all day with his, like, sitting hunched up in a
he has a ninja outfit.
A ninja outfit?
Yes, he is a ninja throughout
this
entire. He's a
literally
hoodie ninja.
A ninja.
He is a hoodie ninja.
He has candy, which I liked.
This conversation is actually kind of pushed me towards watching it more at this point.
It's only an hour and 30 minutes.
I was about to say, it's like, honestly, you take out Light
and his girlfriend,
most of the story, and like maybe an hour and 28 minutes, and you got a good movie.
Yeah, those 2 minutes of L chasing Light where he pushes a dude's face into a bowl of soup.
Oh, yeah.
My favorite moment.
I think mine was when Light was screaming the first time he met Ryuk. It was very, very exaggerated and just awful.
Ooh, speaking of exaggerated, what do you guys think of each of the, like, death scenes?
Not that memorable, I guess.
Yeah.
They were just kind of, like, unexpectedly gory.
Yeah.
But
kind of.
For no particular reason either. Like, when I watch a Tarantino film and it's horribly bloody or something, like, it kind of has a purpose, or at least, like, there's, you can tell that there's some sort of thematic intention, but in this it just seems like they decided to, like, let's do some gory stuff. So it seems like real gruesome
consequences.
Yeah, but that's about it.
Because some things have consequences and other things don't.
Yeah.
But yeah, I like how, I loved how L was, no, how Light was super smart. And the only thing that he did to show it was him doing a thing. And then the super convoluted plan at the very end.
Yeah.
Where he explained his three chapters of the Death Note to fake his coma.
Light is super smart because A, someone says, hey, you're pretty smart. And then B,
right.
At the very end of the movie, he proves that he's capable of doing something competent.
And like at that point, it's almost like not really believable because you have been watching his character the whole time.
Yeah, you've just been watching
him fuck
bumble.
Up.
Yeah.
So it's like, oh, like he really thought about all that? Like,
I don't think. I think you had somebody workshop for you for a couple of minutes. throughout last week when you were like, oh, let's just lay low.
Did the spirit of Willem Dafoe's character in Boondock Saints come out of nowhere and actually tell him what to do behind the scenes?
Probably. Just. Yep. So.
Yeah.
Death
Please
Note.
Kill Me Note gets a thumbs down out of 5.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'm going to say that I really think I should appreciate the anime Death Note a lot more. And it sounds like everyone's seen it. Lizzie, have you seen the anime?
Yes, but okay. It was like 90, a while ago.
90% of the anime she
saw.
Yeah,
I guess I didn't finish it because it got kind of...
convoluted. And because, you know, I think she stopped watching when they went to America.
Yeah.
For a season.
Yeah.
I've
But
saw
I really
bits
enjoyed
and pieces.
The, like, especially the first season. Or like the beginning, I really
leading
liked.
Up to the first L's death, because I mean there are quote unquote multiple L's, you could say.
Mm-hmm. No, there's only one L.
Well,
and then Light turned into L.
Right, exactly.
And
Light
then there was
assumes his identity.
Then there was R.
No,
I remember
it's Mellow N. And Near.
That's one.
M
That's
and N, L M N, and then
actually,
if it didn't work, O P Q R S T U V X Y Z was going to go after Light, so okay. He had quite a bit to contend with.
I'm actually thinking about rewatching it a little bit just because, I don't know, the movie was so awful. I need to almost like rinse my mouth with the real thing.
With a good version?
Yes.
I think the movie makes people appreciate the anime so much more.
Yeah.
Like even the Mellow and Near arc is so much better than this movie.
Yeah.
Yes.
There's something about the anime that like never was able to hook me, even though it's all about convoluted plot twists and plans, and that's exactly up my alley, like in the same way that JoJo's and like Sagrada Reset both have that whole weird like, oh, it seems like we made a mistake there, but one episode later we're going to show that this was all actually under my plan. But there's something about Light Yagami's character that I just can't necessarily get over, and it's purely the fact that like he just comes off as such, like, it's obvious from the get-go, or at least it was to me, that this is, like, the corruption of a character from day one or episode one. Like, having a character that's so smart and given such power, you can only assume that things are going to go downhill, morally speaking, for him.
It's the Breaking Bad narrative of...
Yeah.
Anime, because you can give people that much power and it not turn out that bad. Lelouch, yeah.
Right.
From
Lelouch, though, is like the ultimate case where it doesn't, and even though he's like the ultimate fall guy, and that's maybe why I like Code Geass so much, because even though it seems like
he's an anti-hero the entire time, it's like
he's actually the truest hero.
Yeah,
like he sacrifices himself for the greater good of the world. He realizes by the end of the series, or near the end, that Code Geass, spoilers mind you, that he has to basically become the greatest evil and go down in order to ensure like a longer peace
for his sister.
His sister who he has chained up at the end.
One of my favorite memes ever way back in the day when Code Geass had just come out was a picture of, because it was around, I think it was roughly around the same time that Cinnamon Toast Crunch had the like adults can see why kids love Cinnamon Toast Crunch, but she's holding a box of Fruit Loops.
What?
She's like, even I can see why kids love Cinnamon Toast Crunch.
Because Nunnally is blind through the relationship. Yeah. It's pretty good.
Oh, man.
Anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, so what video games have you guys been playing?
Well, me and my wife are now a two Switch family.
Congratulations. Did you name it? Your second Switch?
Blue, I guess. And mine's been renamed to Red.
Yeah, I'm looking at the two Switches, and what they have done, assumedly picked up one with the blue and red Joy-Con and have swapped the Joy-Cons with their black one. So now one has blue and one has red.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Right. Clever.
We've been playing Splatoon 2.
Which has an awful, awful party system.
It kind of really does.
The worst.
It sucks. So when you get in a match, you can't even jump out if, like...
Say your friend doesn't get in?
Right.
You can't jump out before the match even starts.
Time to just close Splatoon 2.
Well, sometimes you, like, wait for, like, 5 minutes for your group to fill up, and you can't jump out during that time. So you're, like, literally just have to sit there and
wait. So the timer will keep recycling until it parties people up. And you can't, like, form a pre-party to jump in a game at the same time. So what we've been doing is I've had Lizzie jump into a game, and then I'll try to join her when her lobby's filling up. And if that doesn't work, then I just wait for her next game, and then I try to join that game.
It's really sad. And, like, when he does join me, we're not always guaranteed to be on the same team.
I think out of all 30-plus matches we've played, we've been on the same team, like, 6 times?
I would say it's less than 50%. Which is sad, because we want to play together.
Yep.
So
good luck partying up with your random friends using the Switch app. Because actually, if you use the mobile app to party up with your friends, it's not to play publicly. It's to play privately only.
Oh, wow.
Ah, interesting.
Yeah, private matches only.
There is only one way that you can create a pre-party, but it's basically you have to have all 4 people.
Yeah, so during Splatfest, we were like, oh, we can form a party real fast. So we got into the same lobby, and I was like, we both clicked ready, and we're like, it's not going anywhere. And it's just like waiting for the other 2 players to join. I'm like, yeah, we don't have friends to invite.
You could invite Tiffany, I guess, but...
We need her friend code.
Oh, yeah.
We need to get
have her take a picture of her friend code, because friend codes...
Thumbs up.
So it's been interesting. I mean, it's a fun game, but I just wish that you could play with the people you'd want to play with easier and be able to jump out of
douchebag lobbies.
Yeah, that either are taking forever or if, like, your friend doesn't get in it. I don't know.
It seems like this is a growing pattern with Nintendo where, like,
growing pattern or just the same old
consistent
pattern, yeah, where Nintendo. The games are good, but I just wish I could actually play it with my friends.
Right.
Nintendo, thank you for internet, I guess.
Nintendo, make new friends.
I've been playing a lot of Splatoon 2 with Lizzie, and then I've been playing XCOM, Mario.
And Rabbids.
Yeah, Mario
Rabbids Kingdom Battle. It's not that easy.
Wait, really?
It's like I tried to play the first challenge map. So granted, I'm only on world 2-3. So I really like it. So what they do is they set you up in like one big world that's got like little puzzles that you have to solve. Not platformers, because you can't jump outside of battle. And so during these battles, like as you enter into a certain series of battles, they'll say world 1-1 was actually 2 battles. And then after you finish that second battle, you go through a flag that says you're on world 1-2 now. And it's a series of its own battles with like light puzzle solving in between.
You're like the first person that said to me, though, that this game is hard.
So it's more difficult than I was thinking it was going to need to be.
Is it more difficult than XCOM?
In some cases. So like I played the first challenge map. And the first challenge map said the difficulty is very easy. Yeah, no.
Is a challenge map any way different from regular gameplay? Like,
no.
Is it just you have to kill these
enemies, mm-hmm. and then you go on, or you need to save someone.
Yeah, just you need to kill all the enemies on screen.
How much XCOM did you play?
None.
Okay. That's where this conversation is going.
But I have played some XCOM-like games. And comparatively to ones that I've played, those ones actually got some more challenging maps.
What is the reward for doing a challenge map?
I will tell you when I beat one. But I think it's just gold and experience orbs so you can level up your characters and buy new weapons.
Gotcha.
Speaking of buying new weapons, I've also been playing Absolver.
As has Scott. Am I correct?
You are correct.
Ooh, what'd you get it on?
I got it on PC, Cookie, and I'm real sorry.
Well, that's fine. You should have just told me. I'll pick up a second copy.
Oh. Oh, man. I thought I was going to like be feeling some guilt here. It was the day of release, and I was just like, man, I would need another title on PlayStation to play online for me to warrant buying PS Plus. So I bought Absolver.
$60 a year when it's not on sale, right?
Yeah. But I mean, I think you can always find it on sale in some avenue or another. But yeah, I was just like, well, I'll check it out for the PC first. Plus, with my Elite controller, I have those little paddles on the back that I use for games like Dark Souls and now Absolver to perform some actions with my hands still on all of the necessary controls for other stuff.
Like, would you really need the paddles on the back for Absolver?
Not really, no, but it still helps a little bit. Like, you know the...
like, he spent $100 on a controller. He may as well use it, right?
I might as well use it, yeah. You know the D-pad commands, though, to like either pull out your weapon or heal yourself or use some other ability? Like, I have those bound to the paddles, and so like I can push someone to the edge, and then right as soon as my combo finishes, I can use like the shockwave one to push them off of a bridge or something.
And I so dig it. You've got the shockwave one? Fuck me.
Yeah, man, it's great. There's another one I saw that like slows your opponent or whatever.
It's a
gravity move.
Yeah, I've got gravity.
I can't wait to get that. That's the other thing I really like about Absolver too, is like everybody's growth is gonna be pretty
wildly
unique.
Different.
Yeah, like it's super organic. Every person I've fought has been at least slightly different to radically different, which has been really cool. There's a couple questions I have for you then, Cookie, regarding your experience, especially with like the PvP end. But have you encountered many people in like PvP or just PvE plus P interactions?
Yes.
And how have those gone for you? Because I've gotten into a couple and I cannot ever encounter someone who wants to play cooperatively first, but I think I've been a little bit ahead of the game on the amount of time I've been playing, and maybe I'm good at it, but I've just had to beat everybody into submission that I found. And then request them to help me. And then they're like, oh, well, okay, you did just beat me up and revive me.
It's the opposite on the PlayStation, actually. So, like, what normally happens is, because I was playing the other day, and I was like, no, I kind of just want to run through this solo. So I would get requests, and then I deny those requests, and then they'd start trying to beat me up. Like, oh, you don't want to be your friend, huh? So sometimes it turns out good for me, sometimes it turns out bad for me.
I punch people into friendship. That's what I've had to do.
But yeah, so like I've run into some people who have been like, hey, do you want a friend request? And it's like, no, and they'll run away. And that's fine. Some people will, like the aforementioned, gang up on me because I denied them friendship. And I think I've run into like two people who the first time I saw them, they just straight up tried to hit me with the jumping knee elbow power move.
Did you, what's your...
Jumping knee elbow power move. So yeah. They're jumping, they're kneeing and elbowing you at the same time?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is that new fighting game you've been playing?
Yeah.
So I went with the
method? Is it the parry, the dodge, or the like endure?
The dodge.
Dude, always I did the dodge too. The dodge is great.
My plan is to do the dodge, and I've got about three moves unlocked for the Drunken Fist. So I'm constantly, I'm at the moment grinding that one guy at the Coliseum area.
Okay, I know what you're talking about.
To get some more drunken boxing.
I'm getting moves. Lost as fuck on these maps. So lost all the time.
Dark Souls lost?
More than Dark Souls lost. Dark Souls makes sense to me. These maps are even more convoluted. Oh, man. So I'm just like running in circles all the time. But the reason I keep trying to like make, I guess, friends or have people join me is when there's like three or four enemies all at once, those gangs really suck. Like, I don't mind 1v2 and 1v3 if there's like a hazard, like a bridge, I'm kind of okay with because I'll just cheese somebody and push them off the bridge quick.
That usually backfires for me.
Yeah, it can backfire pretty easily, but like when there's three to four, it's really annoying. Like it doesn't feel like a fair challenge. And the camera and lock on isn't good enough for me to feel like confident fighting that many people because I'll screw up on like changing my camera to whoever's attacking me. And within that period of time, someone's punched me in the back of the head or I've like changed my stance accidentally.
Yeah. So one thing I usually do when I've got four people coming after me, I will refer heavily to that block at that point because as soon as you lose track of one person, you don't know what they're going to come up with next.
And I think maybe because I picked the dodge ability as well, like I almost instinctively never use block. I'm all about like dodge it, recover the stamina really quick, and then just flurry of punches and then dodge and flurry of punches and kicks again.
Yeah. So how do you like the combo system?
It's amazing. It's really good. I love building a combat deck. It just feels awesome to like get to weigh all these factors of your like starting and ending stance. I like the whole strength decks kind of split between how your attacks have greater power or speed. And then like the range of attacks and the fact that some of them can stop people from charging or they have you hop over a low attack or duck under a high attack is really cool too. Like how an attack can also be a dodge or an interrupt just makes it that much more satisfying when you land it or when it works to your advantage in a fight.
I've got a kick that moves me forward, but it's also a parry. So like the kick has a little bit of a wind up. And if I get hit during that wind up, the kick actually changes to a low kick instead of a high kick.
I haven't learned anything that cool yet. I do have a lot of kicks. Like I've run a lot of swift kicks that are mostly sweeping. And so I'm just kind of like this spinning cloud of kicks when I'm in my rear stances, which is like
you're in that right stance.
Like backward left and backward right stance. Yeah, backward left is my favorite stance to be in because like I can just combo until my stamina's out and I can just keep landing hits. I kind of have some power in my forward stances a little bit, but I'm mostly dexed build.
I too am mostly a dexed build. And I'll stick with my favorite stances front right because I've got a 1-2 punch quick jab that goes into that that parry kick.
Oh, okay.
That actually, and the parry kick ends back at that back in front left, and then it'll go right back into that 1-2 punch quick jab. So it's kind of a never-ending string of three hits, which works out very wonderfully because the one time that I'm like open, as long as they're not trying to dodge, is during the parry attack.
How do you like the equipment in this game, being able to equip all the different kind of armor types and how that affects your speed? Have you kept your speed at fast or have you gone down to normal or slow?
27 is my speed.
Oh, so you're fast.
I'm very fast. As long as no one's coming at me with a knife, I'm pretty much good to go. I've got everything built up to my block for blunt objects and speed is up. But besides that, my sharp like damage reduction is at like 1.
So you're going to get cut to ribbons if somebody's got a sword.
Yes. So when swords come out, I definitely focus on that person. It's just all dodging.
Yeah.
And are hitting as hard as I can so I can knock the sword out of their hand.
Yeah, it's definitely really cool to be able to disarm an opponent from using a sword or like gloves. by just putting the pressure on them and landing a couple good hits in succession. It's super satisfying when you're fighting a group and you take out the guy with the sword, pick it up, then like turn on the group to do a bunch of damage with that.
So is there much motivation for a single player sort of, or for someone that's interested in story and narrative to play this game?
No, this has less narrative than Dark Souls.
That's impressive.
They were you are selected as an absolver. Have fun.
Please absolve everything you can.
You get a tap on the shoulder and then a mask gets put on your face and then you appear somewhere else and you just start, you learn how to fight and then you just start fighting people. Like that is the story. You've got to beat some people, who cares or who knows why, to climb a tower, to then become a master or like an absolver. And then you're just going to enjoy the PvP experience at that point, which honestly, I think that works to the game's benefit. Like,
I enjoy the PvP experience.
It's really good. Yeah, the PvP experience is why I'm playing it. So,
the one on one, what level are you?
20, maybe. I'm near 20 or slightly above it.
Okay. I'm somewhere between 15 and 20.
Yeah, but so we're close whenever I PvP, to the same, I think.
Well, for now, until I grab it on PC, and then we won't be the same.
What's the level cap?
Catch up pretty quick.
Correct.
Is there a level cap? That's the
correct
question. I don't think that's determined yet.
Is your deck good enough to get a pupil yet?
Get a what?
Pupil?
No. No, my deck's not good enough for that yet. My deck is actually pretty pretty sparse, I think, for how high my level is. Because I know you're supposed to learn from opponents, but every once in a while I'm just like, I'm going to beat the shit out of this guy right now. And I don't give him a chance to respond whatsoever. I just punch him to death. Which is probably the worst way to play Absolver to build your deck, but that's okay. I'll make better progress.
Okay. Well, then that tells me that I probably... Yeah, I'll grab it on thing. I was kind of hoping that you were far enough along to where you could make me a pupil, and then we could just play together.
Well,
we'll need
I
to figure out how the party
that.
System works.
Yeah. We do. There is some password options for partying that I noticed when I was looking through on the connectivity. So I'm not exactly sure how it works, but it could be something as simple as like we can go ahead and set like a keyword. And if our keyword is the same, we'll find each other or like populate into the same server space.
Instance.
Yeah, exactly. So we can do that. I'll work on learning to become a teacher. And I'll also try and be a little bit better about rounding out my deck. That's probably the other thing too, is I feel like once I get a new move, I'm just like, now I'm unstoppable that I have the weak 50 damage, sweeping leg kick. I can't be beaten. But it's going to be fun, and I hope it continues to play well. It's a little buggy. I had the Unreal Engine crash on me once, but it's not horrible. And so I'm really quite satisfied with the launch, and I hope to be playing quite a bit more of it as I finish up on the other games I'm trying to play right now. It's nice to get in just 15-30 minutes on Absolver compared to just about any other game. Like 15 to 30 minutes doesn't feel like enough, but with Absolver, 30 minutes of time in it, when it's such an intensely focused game for the fighting, like it occupies those small spaces very well. This could be a fun thing to play on the Switch if it were on something like that, like that level of portability but also intensity in the small bouts that you play.
That everything would be good on the Switch. So you said you've been trying to play that along with some other games. What else have you been playing?
Damn good segue.
That was amazing. Just
fuck yeah, brother. Hey.
So the other game I've been focusing a lot of time on is Prey, which is the first-person horror shooter that was published by Bethesda and developed by Arkane, who is also responsible for my other favorite kind of gaming series, Dishonored. And you can tell pretty early on because the controls as far as like movement are like feel super similar to Dishonored. They have like a sprint that you can then slide into a crouch, and it is the exact same, like, it's the exact same period of time for the slide and then the crouch. It feels like they took that straight out of Dishonored's mechanics and put it in. But did either of you play Deus Ex at all?
Yes.
Neil did.
Okay, and I mean Human Revolution, but I imagine that, what is it, Mankind Divided, couldn't have been that different. The gameplay feels kind of like Deus Ex, but in its setting, of course, it's in space and not in Detroit. So, you know, space is a lot less desolate than than Detroit, and so that's pretty cool. And then, unlike Deus Ex, I think it's really fun. Like, I've had a lot of fun with it. The powers are really pretty wide in what you can do, and what I'm trying to do to get an achievement is play one playthrough where I only use the human abilities and one playthrough where I only use the... what are they called?
Alien abilities?
Yeah, the alien abilities. I can't remember. The Typhon. That's what it is. The Typhon abilities. And so I'm playing one as female Morgan Yu, engineer and cool person with human abilities. And then the other one I'm playing as psychopath Morgan Yu, the dude who just has Typhon abilities. And I'm just going to like fuck shit up with him. So
quick question. Is there like a... indirect ability that allows you to make people slip and fall in this game?
I mean, I can transform into, say, a coffee cup if I'm a Typhon, and maybe if I roll myself underneath their foot while they're walking, that's actually how I can, you know, like get most of my kills while conserving ammo, is just have them slip and break their neck.
If so,
that's what you'll say.
Please do it.
Yeah, and then I'll go ahead and get the, like, whatever the empathetic achievement is, where I don't kill anybody. I just paralyze everyone on the station.
Please keep Summer safe. But yes, if you can do that, every time that happens, I need you to go, sleep. Thank you. It's from the anime Trapped in Another World, my smartphone.
Oh, I haven't watched any more of that.
It's okay. It stays about the same, and now he just heavily relies on that spell slip. So he was getting into a fight with somebody, and he was like, oh, so all I have to do is just, like, knock you prone, right? And he's like, yeah, pretty much. All right, ready? Begin. Slip.
I do remember that spell, and at the time thinking to myself, this is a JoJo power right here.
Yeah, then he finishes him off with Frizoo or Crickle.
So, would you say so far that you're enjoying Prey more than Dishonored 2?
Than Dishonored 2? No, Dishonored 2 is still better. The map that I played last, like the level that I played last in Dishonored 2 was the Clockwork Mansion. And it's pretty well known. Like, I think it's earned quite a bit of renown for just being a very cool and complex level. The Clockwork Mansion, basically, because I'm not going to talk about Dishonored too much right now, because I'll finish that probably after Prey, since Prey will take me a lot less time to finish. But the Clockwork Mansion, you have two areas prior to the actual mansion that are pretty interesting, but they're your standard kind of Dishonored level. Like, there are multiple ways to approach it, and there are a couple of things that you can do that aren't, or that are like optional for the mission and give you a little bit more context about the game or give you a little bit more of an advantage for later parts of the stage. But the Clockwork Mansion is amazing because you can go into this place and all of these rooms transform. If you pull a lever, they can have they have at least two configurations, if not more, for each room. And so this entire level is just this like puzzle box in which moving one switch transforms the layout on up to, you know, like three different floors or spaces. And it allows for this really, really cool progression through the mansion by either transforming it to your will and seeing how that changes your access to the level, Or what I did is I tried to go through it without ever transforming the mansion, so I wouldn't alert the mark that I was supposed to neutralize. And so that's really cool. You essentially have to find a way to like slip through the slip into the interior kind of walls and the mechanical nooks and crannies of the mansion in order to navigate that way. And it made for a super fun experience. I spent hours playing that level, and I don't know if I've played a level in a game that was designed so intricately and so well that I just felt like I'd never be able to fully comprehend the actual layout. It was super cool. Very, very labyrinthine and very fun to experiment with all the different approaches I could take.
Sounds fun.
It was really cool. Yeah. Prey is not like that. Prey like rewards exploration, but it's one of those things where it's like find a service vent or an air duct to kind of navigate around this locked door or whatnot. There is one really cool item in that game, though, that I wish more games had that would just be, you know, more games could have a very unique utility item like the glue gun that's in Prey. I can use this thing to like put out fires or to seal gaps. So the outside of the space station gets ruptured. And in order to get to this area that's been locked down because of the rupture, I can go out into space and then seal it from the outside with the glue gun. And then that allows me to access this area that was previously locked due to the it not being pressurized. Or I can use it to like create weird little foam trails on the walls that I can climb to get to higher ground, or I can use it to immobilize enemies. Like, there's a million different things you can do with it, and it's so much fun. And I can see how someone could play the game with like just the glue gun and the wrench as their main items.
What do they call the glue gun?
It's G-L-O-O for some sort of acronym, and then gun.
So the glue gun.
Just the first mention of it made me think of like a super soaker shooting Elmer's glue. And I'm like, this doesn't seem effective at all.
It's the Gelifoam Lattice Organism Obstructor, or glue cannon. There we go. That's what it's
lattice?
Called. Yeah. Well,
lattice sounds like a fake word to get this to...
Wait, no, lattice?
No, it totally,
no, lattice is a real thing.
It totally lattice. Makes sense that it's a lattice because it's forming like a macromolecular structure. And so it is like forming this sort of almost mineral lattice when it hits things. It
like
totally makes
lattice
sense.
Lattice work, right?
L-A-T-T-I-C-E. Yes.
Interesting.
Yeah. So it's like a glue that hardens into this almost stone-like hexagonal orb. And then it can be used for all sorts of things. Like I stopped an electrical box from surging or like hitting me with arcs of electricity by gluing over it for a little bit.
So what you're saying is this is basically new age duct tape.
Yeah, exactly. It's space age duct tape, which should be the like most useful tool ever. It's great. And there's a lot of really fun stuff with the game too. Like it very much follows the Bethesda style storytelling through item placement and other little like illustrative corners of notes and other relevant, like, I guess, books and things like that. So for instance, I found a snowman that was made out of glue cannon orbs, and then it had some items that I can like recycle for materials to craft stuff later, which is really cool too. You can craft almost any item that you need once you get the fabrication plans for it.
Do they use audio logs as well?
Yeah, they use audio logs, they use textbooks, and they use computers very similar to Deus Ex, where you can hack them to get in or you can try and find passwords. So like I found the glue snowman and it had a note next to it, and then there was some terminal references to it at other points in time. Some of the other weapons and items are really cool too. Like there's one called the Huntress Boltcaster, and it's a Nerf crossbow. Like it is a Nerf crossbow, but I can use the Nerf darts to hit computer screens to, like, since they're all touchscreen, I can hit, like, the open door command on the computer screen if I can look through the little slot in the glass window or something.
Oh, so to basically allow for like some creative puzzle solving, so to speak.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's really cool. There's a lot of like reading that's thematically relevant to Prey, I think, finds its strength in like surprising the player with both the gameplay elements that occur, like the mimics transforming from objects in the environment and other like kind of jump scare surprises and things like that, as well as narrative surprises. I don't know where this story's going, and I don't know if it's good or not yet, but it's certainly something that I can't follow it and expect exactly what the next outcome will most likely be.
I've heard some pretty good things about the ending, so I think you should be looking forward to it.
That's good.
In the interest of making progress, I just realized that we're getting close to 50 minutes.
And we still haven't even opened the hot pot.
Uh-oh. No, we haven't.
Uh-oh.
So, Neil, what have you been playing?
Yeah, I'll really quickly just say that. I finished The Letter, or at least my first couple playthroughs of it now. And I definitely have a much better understanding of how that game works and how the butterfly effect is quite literally a butterfly effect, where the smallest choice can basically put you on a completely different route. So I do really want to commend that game for having like a really well-written, if not terribly edited, story and script. But we are going to start uploading videos of The Letter with Scott and I. And at any point in time, if you want to join in, Cookie, like it might be weird to jump in until I get the first videos out, so you could catch yourself up if you're interested.
Makes sense. Ooh, but speaking of videos of The Letter, can we do videos of Hot Tofu Boyfriend?
I guess so. Yeah, if you want to, I'm game. I am totally game for that.
It's free PlayStation Plus game, man.
Oh, so
for okay. September. So I'm not even buying it.
Yeah. So fucking do it.
Good reason to play it.
You're gonna fall in love with
all the
your
pigeons.
Favorite pigeon or favorite.
Nope,
bird.
Nope. Going for a reverse harem. Cause
you wanna get all the birds?
I'm gonna get all the birds.
Bird is the word after all.
Yeah. Sorry to cut you short.
Oh, no, it's fine. That's all I really want to say on it. It's a good game. I think it was well worth like the $18 or whatever I spent on it. I know I said I was going to talk about Sonic Mania and West of Loathing, but after listening to the last podcast, I kind of realized I had said like more than enough, you know. they are what I thought they were. But yeah, let's talk about some news and some things we couldn't cover or we didn't have time to cover last week.
All right, here, guys, here's that sound y'all like.
What? Was that the sound of a pot opening up?
Yeah, the hot pot.
Oh my God.
Scott, why don't you tell us about Ni No Kuni 2?
Did either of you guys play Ni No Kuni 1, The Wrath of the White Witch or something like that?
I started the first one and played a little bit. One of my roommates at the time had purchased it, and I thought it was kind of interesting, although like lower variety, better battle system Pokemon.
Yeah, okay, that's kind of what I've heard about it. And I had been interested in it as well, but since my interest in Pokemon started to wane as I got less tolerant to grinding, I decided not to really go into it, but I've kept my eye on Ni No Kuni 2, and recently it was released that they will be revamping their combat system to get away from that old classic JRPG turn-based combat system, and they're now going to have this game with two different types of combat. One of them is going to be similar to other JRPG games in which the like player character has a little bit more agency and they can perform actions against, you know, the monsters and enemies. I think it kind of looks to me like what MMORPG games like, say, Final Fantasy XIV have for their combat system. You have more free movement, but the attacks that you perform are all kind of like special abilities that either affect a targeted enemy or you have kind of like an area of effect kind of spell, but they'll have that for, I believe, their main combat system, and that'll be for most of their boss fights and whatnot. But as a secondary version of combat, there's kind of like this overworld troop battle thing where you essentially navigate over a kind of zoomed out overworld, or a slightly zoomed in overworld is what I should say, with your character acting as a leader and then having a bunch of troops that fight in rock, paper, scissors matches while you progress towards an objective. And it looks a lot more fun than the turn-based combat, in my opinion. So I think they're reaching out to engage like a more Western audience and to update sort of what the JRPG version of combat is. Like, I hope that that's a change that will be present in more video games in the future.
Can we start a war based on rock, paper, scissors, please? Where we literally have troops of people playing rock, paper, scissors to advance or retreat.
I mean, just play.
In some sense, that sort of system's been implemented in other games before.
Right. I know fighting games are rock, paper, scissors, but you know, I literally want them to play rock, paper, scissors now.
The first version of their battle system in Ni No Kuni 1 was like a really well disguised active turn based battle system, but not having as much to do with the main character or like your playable character aside from like, if I remember correctly, some supportive spells, it just, the entire idea of the game felt weird because it's like, yeah, it's literally what Pokemon should be, where you are a free running person and your Pokemon are like in this geographical world. I say that as opposed to like a menu driven battle system, mm-hmm. where they're freely in open combat with the other Pokemon. But at the same time, like given this, like the grandeur of what Ni No Kuni is supposed to be or is, I should say, maybe I'm just like, I could have the unpopular opinion here. Towering over your enemies and, or at least the majority of your random encounters and your own monster, it just feels kind of weird that you're basically playing chicken fighting or dog fighting. Like,
why don't you just bonk the monsters over the head with your rod or whatever?
Exactly. Just something about it feels weird and awkward to me. But you're absolutely right. Like, giving the player more agency, I think, allows for this game to potentially be, in my opinion, a good game.
And this is weird.
The war system is definitely interesting to some aspect, and it's definitely suitable because I think you play as like a prince or something.
Yeah,
in the second game.
You play as a prince, and what is it? You play as a prince with cat ears, or maybe fox ears. You've got animal ears.
Yeah, you gotta appeal to the furry audience.
Kawaii.
Yeah, but yeah, so it makes sense that you could command a lot of troops. Their boss fights looked like they would be pretty fun. So I'm looking forward to it. And it's a very pretty game from what I can see as well. This is one of those collaborations with Studio Ghibli animators, I believe. Is it Ghibli or Ghibli? Mm-hmm. I mean,
it's a Ghibli.
It is. Okay.
It's a J sound. I found out myself. I confirmed it myself because I've been calling it Ghibli as well as of late. And then
Studio Ghibli.
Yeah.
Studio Ghibli.
While we're on the topic of JRPGs, a Square classic from the Super Famicom and SNES, Secret of Mana is getting a remake for the PS4, Vita, and Steam, with a currently slated release date for February 15th, 2018. Interesting to point out because this is one Square RPG that is showing up on the SNES classic, and certainly makes sense that they put it on that now that we find out they're making a remake for it.
They're going to build the hype.
Yeah, not much to say about it too far. Ark Survival is getting a TV show.
How?
By the
what?
Staff of Game of Thrones.
It sounds like possibly the most unbelievable thing that's happened yet with Ark Survival.
You mean unbelievable within the sense of the storyline, or unbelievable that like this is the dumbest idea?
Unbelievable as in like Donald Trump is our president. Unbelievable.
Well, you know what?
Like defies all reason.
we have come to the age where Shenmue 3 is coming out. Donald Trump is president, and anything can happen.
So what would this show be?
Dinosaurs, man. Jurassic Park on steroids. Shooting dinosaurs, riding dinosaurs, being friends with dinosaurs, so having like good cop, bad cop relationships with dinosaurs.
So it's going to be a live action end game of Ark Survival?
It's a live action MMO, yes.
Maybe it'll be an MMO in the game. Like, maybe the game is about a bunch of kids playing Ark Survival.
And then they fall into comas, and they're stuck in Ark Survival. They've got to make it their new reality.
Oh, that's so 2001, Scott.
And then they have to go and find the creator of the game, who's at the top of the Ark Survival Tower, and beat him in order to release themselves.
Oh, that's so 2016, Neil.
They're going to call it Re-Ark Survival Zero. Slash night.
That's so 2017, Scott.
But that's a thing. I mean, in the world where Netflix, in this reality where Netflix is able to like come up with all these crazy recreations or like new series, I guess, and so forth, and all the good that comes of it, I guess we have to take some of the bad.
You mean like GameStop saying that its expensive SNES classics in Switch bundles are more convenient for people?
That's not bad. That's ludicrous.
Ludicrous speed.
Yeah, it's...
I didn't have a follow-up.
There isn't a follow-up to it. He's just outright saying like, well, our overpriced packages that sell you that Mega Man figurine helmet you've always wanted, even though you've never played Mega Man. I mean, it's for your benefit as the customer, not for ours as the distributor.
Credit to where it's due. This is a GameStop, or GameStop, excuse me. Definitely not a GameStop.
It's a GameSpot article,
but I believe
this
was a GameSpot article.
If you move some letters around, it is a GameStop article.
Well, they're doing a great job of not supporting their quote-unquote...
Circle of life?
Shadow partner, I guess, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
Or the quote here is, we really try to do a great job of pairing up items with things customers like to buy. In the case of the Switch, we know the customer is going to want a way to charge the Joy-Con, so we often throw in a charging device. We know the Switch has limited memory, and customers like to download games, so we'll add a memory stick.
We know that customers want to decorate their houses with shitty figurines, so we go ahead and we throw in four of those.
Yeah, the comparison is ridiculous.
He's referencing items that are more convenient in packages. I don't disagree that the memory card option or the Joy-Con controller is a good thing to bundle in, but
wait,
I don't think
that's
those? Where people are complaining at all.
I love the article illustrates a SNES console along with a banana, because that's quite literally more useful than a lot of the bundles ThinkGeek came up with.
Yeah,
because I can at least eat the banana.
You can use it for scale, so you can measure if your SNES will fit in the space or not.
I need to take a picture of this random object with a banana to give you an idea of how big it is.
You can go ahead and use the banana as a controller for Dark Souls play. There's so many things you can do with a
banana. Hit it with a quick makey-makey. There you go. Yeah.
And when it starts going bad, you could probably give the banana to like a child, and they could pretend it's a phone, a banana phone.
You could make banana bread and then keep the peel and use it as a slip spell.
Yeah, sleep. Exactly.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. Wow. GameSpot may have come up with bundle of the year right here.
Well, unfortunately, this bundle is not a real bundle.
Unless you're buying it from Bob the Scamp.
Customers have the opportunity to come into our stores and choose the accessories that they would like to bundle with their hardware, or buy online the predetermined bundles we have put together to help making the shopping experience more convenient.
Okay.
So what he's basically saying is customers have the opportunity to come inside the store and buy the thing that they want, or they can buy the thing with other things for the same price as if they were buying them all separate.
Exactly. Yep.
Also, he's saying that customers can go in the store and actually see these Nintendo products in the store.
And magically, the cost of all of these accessories went up just a bit before the NES Classic bundles were released, too.
So,
What?
Speaking of items that, you know, receive other things kind of packaged in with them to maybe validate a higher price. Have you heard about the Street Fighter II cartridges that are getting released on the 30-year anniversary?
You mean the ones that are being released on the NES? No, the SNES cartridge?
Yeah.
Old
SNES cartridges. Well, they're not old cartridges, but if you have a SNES, chances are that's old.
For the record, this is not done by Capcom, like first-party-wise. Obviously, it was licensed out at some point. For this company to do it. And the company eludes me right now.
I am 8-bit.
That's exactly right. The one thing I remember when I was putting together this list of topics was that when you pre-order one of these or order one of these Street Fighter 2 cards, there's no guarantee that you're going to get, like, there's no choice in the colors. So whether you get the red one, which I think is the limited, like, 1,000 quantity version of it, or just the plain cart, it's sort of a crapshoot. But when I was recreating this list today, I noticed a very interesting title basically saying that these carts may blow up if you use them.
No. I don't think that's right. I think the hardware itself will overheat and not the cartridges. Oh, and okay, 4,500 of the cartridges will be opaque Ryu red, and the remaining 1,000 are translucent glow-in-the-dark Blanca green.
Okay, but there we go. So they're the Blanca ones that are the uncommon ones.
Yeah, but they are warning the new release could be a fire hazard, which will cause older systems to overheat. So I really want to give the Nerdist article that I found for this credit for a great line that says, it might just shuriken your system, in other words.
That's so cool that they were still releasing games for the SNES.
Man, if only they were releasing SNESs.
That won't start on fire, that won't overheat.
Oh, that shoot. Won't take cartridges.
Yeah.
I just don't understand, like, I don't know. Why release something that's going to potentially be a hazard?
Wait, are we talking about the old Samsung products?
I guess we're talking about everything at this point, because now you have to worry about getting run over by going out and getting an SNES Classic, which won't unfortunately work with your new Street Fighter 2 cart.
You know, we have so many complaints these days about, you know, like homegrown terrorists making IEDs and whatnot. But when we can purchase them from the next biggest electronics retailer as a gaming system or a phone, it's a little curious why they don't go ahead and do a crackdown on the distributors for maybe making products that don't explode. So we can't use them that way.
The one thing that keeps people in check is their stock market values. Stock market values.
Stock
Am
market.
I from Boston?
Yeah, I guess so, Neil.
Just as a final closing topic, I did not realize that The Impatient, the game for the PSVR that's coming out, now I'm blanking. That's actually a in-universe prequel to Until Dawn. Did you know that, Cookie?
You didn't know that?
No, I didn't. I just assumed it was a standalone VR experience.
I totally thought it was suggested that it was a Until Dawn prequel. I could have sworn there was at least some sort of reference to that when I was watching all of the big reveal trailers for E3 this year. But
that was the thing. That's when I was looking back on the E3, that Sony E3 presentation, I didn't think there was anything that alluded that it was the same
universe
asylum as the Until Dawn asylum.
I guess I just thought, since there was a psychiatrist or whatever, and Until Dawn also heavily featured a psychiatrist in the beginning, that maybe they were related. I assume they were related, so
they just couldn't afford who's the psychiatrist in Until Dawn now?
I don't know.
The Bond villain, or is he a Bond villain? I feel like he's a Bond villain at some point in time.
I feel like everyone's a Bond villain at some point in time.
Yeah, regardless. Makes me a lot more interested in playing that game, though. Like, I was already kind of sold on The Impatient, but seeing that it's now linked to Until Dawn makes me even more curious and interested, because the asylum that it takes place in is closed down by the events of Until Dawn.
Well, you can certainly buy a PSVR.
I could. Wait, did you sell yours?
No. No. I'm selling it.
I see where this is going.
There's also a price drop on PSVRs coming up, isn't there? Or has it
and
already
there's been
taken
a permanent
place?
Price drop on all of the headsets at this point. So I'm starting to wonder just how soon it'll be until we hear about the second generation.
I believe everyone's speculating 2018, early 2018, when they're going to
that sounds about
start
right.
really pushing for it. But right now they've got, for the HTC Vive, an official, kind of unofficial announcement, because everyone can mod these things because how open source everything is.
At least the HTC Vive.
Yeah. So there's like an official, unofficial, already wireless version. And I'm super excited for the HTC Knuckle to come out.
Yeah, that controller looks... That literally is like
that is the right direction. That's the phrase I'm looking for. Because I mean, the as much as the touch, it is the Oculus Touch is like a more natural controller. You still have to hold the controller as opposed to that knuckle where your hands are open. Like,
and it's still
that's powerful.
Yeah. So you can bitch slap anyone you want.
Yeah. You know, I don't know. I don't necessarily need to go into it that much, but VR certainly seems like it's
going places.
More, yeah, it's becoming more and more interesting. And like it certainly seems like the next iteration of it should make some big waves. But I think that just about does it for
Omake!
Episode 30 of the Fancy Ramen Podcast. If you have comments, questions, or corrections, you can write in to podcast@fancyramen.com. And if you're watching on YouTube or listening on YouTube, you can comment below as well.
Best way to
grow
our fan
base. Enjoying
the
show, leave a review with us on Apple Podcasts, iTunes, or your favorite podcasting service. But more importantly, tell a friend and help us grow our audience.
Neil's getting all
also,
these accents near the end of the recordings.
Hour. Because we don't like minute audiences. My new audiences. Oh, the fucking wordplay is next level.
Omake! One day. If you have any questions about what we're going to watch next, send us some suggestions.
Oh, yeah, that's a good idea.
You can also send us money. Have a good day!
Cookie really wants to get that second generation VR stuff accounted for.
Oh yeah,
as soon as possible.
Did you buy a Rift or am I crazy?
I did not buy a Rift.
Okay,
you are crazy.
Because like at the price points they are now, something made me think that you might have picked up a Rift.
At the price points they are now, I definitely have been walking into a Best Buy looking like, you know, I could buy that Rift.
Then you'd have all three headsets.
The big three. And yet, still not much to play.
And yet, still not satisfied.
So I'm just going to stick with making skateboards for right now.
I'm Neil.
I'm Cookie.
I'm Scott.
Lizzie's gone.
Oh, okay, I was waiting.
She abandoned the podcast at some point.
I want to cut her off again. And I'm Scott again. Thanks for listening.